A reading from Deuteronomy. And the Lord your God will make you abundantly prosperous in all your undertakings, in the fruit of your body, in the fruit of your livestock, and in the fruit of your soil. For the Lord will again take delight in prospering you, just as he delighted in prospering your ancestors, when you obey the Lord your God by observing his commandments and decrees that are written in this book of the law, because you turn to the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul. Surely this commandment that I am commanding you today is not too hard for you, nor is it too far away. It is not in heaven that you should say, who will go up to heaven for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? Neither is it beyond the sea that you should say, who will cross to the other side of the sea for us and get it for us so that we may hear it and observe it? No, the word is very near to you. It is in your mouth and in your heart for you to observe. Word of God, word of life.
Thanks be to God.
Show me the ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. To you, O Lord, I lift up my soul. My God, I put my trust in you. Let me not be put to shame, nor let my enemies triumph over me. Let none who look to you be put to shame. Rather, let those be put to shame who are treacherous. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths. Lead me in your truth and teach me, for you are the God of my salvation. In you have I trusted all the day long. Remember, O Lord, your compassion and love, for they are from everlasting. Remember not the sins of my youth and my transgressions. Remember me according to your love and for the sake of your goodness, O Lord. You are gracious and upright, O Lord. Therefore you teach sinners in your way. You lead the lowly in justice and teach the lowly your way. All your paths, O Lord, are steadfast love and faithfulness to those who keep your covenant and your testimonies. Show me your ways, O Lord, and teach me your paths.
All the children come forward, please. If nothing else, you might want to sit in one of these front seats because we have a bit of a video for you today. Hello. Oh, nice, yes. Very well done. Thank you. So, some of you might have recognized that little tune. Today, we're going to talk about neighbors. And so I have a question for the littlest ones. Have you heard the word neighbor before? Have you heard that word before? Yeah. And maybe for our bigger ones, what does it mean to be a neighbor? Any bigger one can tell me. What does it mean to be a neighbor? Might be helpful. You wave to them. Maybe you live next door. What's our neighbor's name, Addie? Do you remember?
Kristen.
Christian. And so we went to my parents' house, and there was kids next door there, so she called them Christian too. I thought, that's pretty cool if neighbor means Christian and Christian means neighbor, although we don't have the market on being neighbors. Let's be honest about that too, right? And who are our country's neighbors? I bet you know that. To the north we have Canada, and to the south we have Mexico. Yeah, so those are neighbors. But neighbors goes beyond just location and geography, right? It is about how we treat each other and how we look out for one another and support one another. When I was growing up, there was a show that I loved to watch. I think lots of you did too. And so Mr. Rogers liked to sing about being a neighbor and talk about being a neighbor, and I could tell you what he sang, but why don't we just watch it?
It's a beautiful day in this neighborhood, a beautiful day for a neighbor. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? It's a neighborly day in this beauty wood, neighborly day for a beauty. Would you be mine? Could you be mine? I have always wanted to have a neighbor just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you, so let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, would you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please, won't you be my neighbor?
And so Mr. Rogers didn't just sing and talk about being a neighbor. He actually lived out what it looks like to be a neighbor as well. One of the things he did was make sure that everyone he encountered knew how special they were. And that included those of us on the other side of the TV. I really knew that. And what I want you to know is that the way Mr. Rogers welcomed everyone onto his show and into his life is the way I felt welcomed here. And I want you to also know that the way he treated everyone like they were special and important is the way I plan and hope to treat all of you as well. And all of you littlest ones and big little ones, know that you are so very important as everyone else in this congregation. Okay. Good morning, boys and girls. Thanks for joining me here today. You can go sit down, okay? The Holy Gospel according to St. Luke. Glory to you, O Lord. Just then, a lawyer stood up to test Jesus. Teacher, he said, what must I do to inherit eternal life? He said to him, what is written in the law? What do you read there? And he answered, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart and with all your soul and with all your strength and with all your mind and your neighbor as yourself. And he said to him, you have given the right answer. Do this and you will live. But wanting to justify himself, he asked Jesus, and who is my neighbor? Jesus replied, a man who was going down from Jerusalem to Jericho fell into the hands of robbers who stripped him, beat him, and went away, leaving him half dead. Now by chance, a priest was going down that road, and when he saw him, he passed by on the other side. So likewise a Levite, when he came to the place and saw him, he passed by on the other side. But a Samaritan, while traveling, came near him, and when he saw him, he was moved with pity. He went to him and bandaged his wounds, having poured oil and wine on them. Then he put him on his own animal, brought him to an inn, and took care of him. The next day he took out 2 denarii, gave them to the innkeeper and said, "Take care of him, and when I come back, I will repay you whatever more you spend." Which of these three do you think was a neighbor to the man who fell into the hands of robbers? He said, "The one who showed him mercy." And Jesus said to him, "Go and do likewise." The Gospel of the Lord. Praise to you, O Christ. Be seated. The pulpit is no place for politics. This is the advice I have received a few times since I started ministry in the United States. Whatever you do, don't preach politics. You know, people often ask me if I notice any major differences between living in Canada and the US. And truth be told, most of my answers revolve around the grocery store. I say, there's no French on your cereal boxes. And the Hy-Vee doesn't close early on Sunday. Your butter comes in four individual sticks instead of one big brick, which, by the way, is very handy. And you don't have my favorite brand of tomato soup or apple juice. But other than that, Minnesota and Manitoba aren't all that different. Oh, except for the politics. Now, let me just state the obvious. In this country, at this time, talking about politics is one of the best ways you can polarize people. With only two major political parties to identify with, all it takes is a quick back and forth conversation to determine whether someone is your people or one of those people. Now, don't get me wrong, we're great at doing this in Canada too, making snap judgments about a person's character and intelligence based on a simplified response to a hot button issue. We just don't have those two neat, albeit horrendously stereotyped, categories to put people in. So, don't preach politics. And I think, you know, there's some validity in this advice. Still, some people worry that following it means pastors are sticking their heads in the sand to avoid saying anything controversial. But I don't think that's necessarily true. One pastor puts it this way. Politics and theology both deal with moral and ethical issues, so it's impossible to preach biblically without having some overlap with the political issues of the day. If the passage I'm preaching on deals with the underlying issue, I preach on it, but I won't be partisan about it. You know, I tend to think this is a good approach. Preach on the issue, not on the politician or the political party. But is it realistic? I mean, is it possible to preach on an issue in a way that doesn't even subtly convict one group while praising another? And what is the listener's role in all of this? How can we ditch the labels that we've put upon ourselves and then open our minds to hearing something new in the biblical text? To hear a word from God that may challenge or even convict us while still upholding and cherishing us? You know, I think this world desperately needs a place where we can come together without all those labels, where our accomplishments count as little as our failures, and where everyone can be loved and nourished in the same way. And communion is one place where this happens. As much as humanity has tried to limit and control the sacrament of communion over the centuries, God's promise and presence will not be undermined. When you come to the table to receive bread and wine or juice, you are equal in every way with everyone who has given or received this gift across time and space. You know, and I would like to suggest that we come to today's gospel text as equals as well. That when Jesus speaks to us through this parable, there are none among us who will not feel convicted. And there are none among us who should not feel comforted as well. Because when we let Jesus' words speak to the core of who we are, that's when they have the power to change us. You know, this story from Luke is widely known as the parable of the Good Samaritan. It's actually so well known that many people reference it without even knowing it's from the Bible. A good Samaritan is simply someone who comes to the aid of another. And there's something to be said for that simplicity. Don't walk by. Offer help. Period. Because for the most part, we like clear directions, simple rules. You know, it seems this is what the lawyer was looking for too when he asked the question, what must I do to inherit eternal life? Or maybe a more helpful interpretation for our context is, what must I do to be in good relationship with God? And Jesus, the great teacher that he is, has the lawyer answer for himself. I mean, after all, he already knows the answer. You shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your strength, with all your mind, and your neighbor as yourself. And there it is, clear direction. There's just one problem. Love your neighbor. It's too vague. So the lawyer seeks to clarify. Who is my neighbor? And Jesus tells a parable. This morning, we got to listen, along with the lawyer, to Jesus' response. We got to hear of a man traveling from Jerusalem to Jericho. And it might be good for us to remember that that journey was dangerous in his time. And it's impossible in our time, because a wall has now been built between the two places. Now the man is jumped, he's robbed, he's beaten, and he's left for dead. He needs help. And we think we know where Jesus is going with this. This stranger is our neighbor that needs to be helped. Now the parable goes on. Two people we assume should help him see him, but cross over to the other side of the road and ignore him. It is the unlikely Samaritan who not only helps him, but goes above and beyond. And then Jesus asks the question, who was a neighbor to this man? And that question is so similar to the one that the lawyer asked, who is my neighbor, that we can be fooled into thinking Jesus is actually answering his question, when really he changed the question entirely. See, the lawyer wanted parameters around who we need to love, include, protect, provide for. Surely we can't go above and beyond for everyone. But Jesus wasn't interested in defining who our neighbor is. Instead, Jesus gives us a picture of what it looks like when we love our neighbor. Who was a neighbor to this man? Jesus asks. The one who showed him mercy. Go and do likewise. My grandpa Don tells this story about selling his home. It was before everything was done by real estate agents, and the homeowners could actually meet potential buyers and answer questions they might have face to face. And so he recalls one buyer asking him, how are the neighbors? You know, what a good question, I thought. You can change a lot about a house, but you can't change the neighbors. But Grandpa Don saw it differently. Instead of assuring the buyer that the neighbors were responsible, kind, respectful, he responded with what he felt was a much more important question. What kind of neighbor are you? He asked. I think Grandpa Don and Mr. Rogers have something in common. When Mr. Rogers asked, would you be my neighbor? I never got the sense that he wanted anything from us. I think he was asking if we would let him love and care for us. Because he knew that having someone who loves and cares for you makes all the difference in the world. I have always wanted to have a neighbor, just like you. I've always wanted to live in a neighborhood with you. So let's make the most of this beautiful day. Since we're together, we might as well say, won't you be mine? Could you be mine? Won't you be my neighbor? Won't you please? Won't you please? Please won't you be my neighbor. Amen.